डेवलप करना चाहिए
जी हाँ जी हाँ
बिकॉज इट शुड गो ऑन,
यस वेरी राइट
क्योंकि मेच्योरिटी विद टाइम भी आती है बहुत सारी।
स्टार्ट कर लो क्या?
हाँ करो
एक सेकंड से दे, जस्ट नीड वन मिनट।
हमारा पांच पांच का टारगेट होता है।
एक देवेंद्र सर, स्क्रीन शेयर एनेबल कर दीजिएगा मेरे लिए।
सर स्टार्ट कर दीजिए।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी, आई ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ नॉर्थ एक्सियन स्टडी सर्कल वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन द टुडेज वेबिनार ऑन द प्रोजेक्टिव स्कीम ऑफ टैक्सेशन एंड इट्स एंट्री केसेस एंड हाउ टू हैंडल पेनल्टी नोटिस रिसीव्ड अंडर सेक्शन 270A एंड अदर पेनल्टीज दैट इज टेकन बाय डॉक्टर राकेश गुप्ता, वेरी नोन पर्सनैलिटी एंड ओवर द टॉर्च बीरर ऑफ ओवर प्रोफेशन। He is an ex-member of ITAT and by C.S. Somil Agarwal. He is also very prominent, handsome and very young and energetic chartered accountant. And so first of all, I with myself and my convener, Dr. C.A. Rajesh Arora ji and Arun Gupta ji and Ashok Gadri and Ashok Gupta ji, and today we with us there is a very learned person, Dr. C. A. Ashok Sharma is there, and he is the advisor. He is also the guest for the today's webinar. So I request Dr. Rakesh Gupta ji, come over there. It is the profile of Dr. Rakesh Gupta ji. Dr. Rakesh Gupta is a fellow member of ICI and ICSI both. He is a gold medalist in his LLB examination, hold master degree in law and management. He has done PhD in corporate governance and business ethics. He practices as a chartered accountant from 1984-2000 before he has appointed as a member of Income Tax Appellate Tribunal in the year 2000 when he was 37 years of age. Dr. Gupta resigned from ITAT and resumed his practice as an advocate representing income tax cases before various high courts and honorable Supreme Court of India. He has over three decades of rich experience in tax and business advisory matters. He represents UP government in Supreme Court of India as a special counsel. Dr. Gupta is an eloquent speaker, has addressed several seminars. A load seminars and workshop on legal and practical topics relating to income tax, and has co-authored a detailed commentary on law relating to search and seizure. He has been contributing article in various professional magazines, writing columns in newspaper, and making appearance on various television channels. So first I welcome sir on today's webinar, and our second guest speaker is Dr. C.S. Somil Agarwal ji, and his profile is a lawyer by profession and qualified chartered accountant. He is also associate member of Institute of Company Secretaries of India, also the associate member of Institute of Cost and Management Accountant of India. He has also held master in commerce commercial law from University of Birmingham, UK, and diploma in ISA by ICI. He is regularly appears before various branches of Income Tax Appellate Tribunals, High Court, and Supreme Court of India, and several cases argued by him have been reported in leading tax journals. He is regularly invited by various chambers and study circles. So I welcome C.S. Somil Agarwal ji, and with these words, I request Dr. Rakesh Gupta ji to start his deliberations.
Welcome, sir. Welcome, both of you, sir.
Thank you. Very respected Shri Ashok Sharma Sahab. एंड श्री अरुण गुप्ता जी, डिप्टी कन्वीनर श्री राजेश अरोड़ा जी, एंड ऑफ कोर्स रमन जी, देन अशोक गुप्ता जी, एंड ए गैलेक्सी ऑफ माय प्रोफेशनल फ्रेंड्स हु आर लिसनिंग एंड दिस डेलिबरेशंस. फ्रेंड्स, द टॉपिक्स व्हिच हैव बीन ईयरमार्क्ड फॉर टुडेज डेलिबरेशंस रिवॉल्व अराउंड द पेनल्टी under section 270A and other penalties and presumptive scheme of taxation. Though the scope of both of these topics are very wide, and we'll have to see whether and to what extent, I mean, these topics can be covered, but then certain important issues we would like to touch upon. Now, assessments are getting completed, and along with the assessments, the penalty notices are being issued. Some penalty notices in those cases where the CIT appeals have already decided the appeals, now they are also coming. And therefore, particularly in the latter kind of the notices, it may not subserve the purpose by merely writing that the penalty proceedings may please be kept in abeyance. We'll have to give reply on merit. There are other penalty notices, I mean, which are also issued, even divorce the assessment. Penalty notice may be under 271D for accepting loan or deposit or specified sum otherwise than through the banking channel, or the repayment of these amounts under section 2 penalty under section 271E. I mean, there are whole hosts of penalty. I remember that on one occasion, Somil calculated the number of penalties and they were 30. And in section 272A, there were as many as 16 defaults. So in all, there are 46 defaults, I mean, which are to be visited with penalty. There are total 298 sections. So you can very well imagine that at every step, I mean, there is a penalty provision. But then have we ever thought as to why these penalty provisions are enacted in any statute? So the first objective is to send the deterrence message that those who commit defaults or those who are the fence sitters and may end up in committing defaults should know that here are the penalty provisions to take care of them. And the second is to seek compensation for the state, because the state is injured by an action of default or by an action of an attempt to evade tax. The state, which is an organized conglomerate system, I mean, that gets injured. So it is a compensation for that injury. And of course, the objective of the penalty provision is not to break the taxpayer. Of course, the objective is to bend the taxpayer. So with these laudable objectives, the penalty provisions are inbuilt into any system. Our Income Tax Act is not an exception to it. So today I would request Somil to deal as to how penalty notice under section 270 capital A has to be approached. What is the meaning of underreported income? What is the meaning of underreported income in consequence to misreporting of income in simplest manner? And how can one bring down the rigor, the magnitude, the quantum of penalty under section 270 capital A, who can impose penalty and with reference to which amount the penalty can be levied, so on and so forth. So with this background, I would request Somil to kindly start his deliberations for 35, 40, 45 minutes. And then even if there are certain other penalty provisions, I will take care. And then I will pick up my topic of the presumptive scheme of taxation. And I'll try to raise certain very interesting issues. So with this, I present Somil Agrawal.
Should I add something?
Sure.
Ji.
Yes, sir.
Before he starts.
Okay, sir.
I'll request him to touch upon the basic things, which I think linking of 270 capital A along with 271 AAD, because certain provisions are common. Falsification of books, no omission of an entry, making a false entry, they are also under misreporting, attracting 200% penalty. And the similar provision, the same items, are in 271 AAD, where the 100% penalty of the amount, not the tax, is to be imposed not only on the person, the assessee doing so, anybody who is inducing, helping him to do so, will also be there. Plus, what is the implication and what is the meaning of the mens rea? To what extent it is relevant even today under the new penalty regime? And one more small point, I don't want to add many. There is always an issue of estimation of income. If income is estimated, then penalty is not to be imposed. But if we look at Section 270 capital A, they have excluded a particular case of estimation will not be taken as a underreporting only when the books of accounts are accepted or not rejected by the assessing officer. And he is only not approving the method of computing the income. He says that method is not appropriate. So those are the things. So I think mens rea, estimation, and connection with falsification, etc. They should, I suggest, Rakesh ji kare.
Yes, no. So Subil will do. And I tell you, I mean, when in the first lockdown, probably our first two articles authored by me and Somil was on 271 AAD and Section 270 capital A only. And both these articles, and rather I would say the most of our articles, I mean, are on the first principles of law. We do take assistance of the established judicial decisions, but then very seldom. And we try to make out a case for or against whatever is this interpretations based on the first principles of law. So Swamil would now start with deliberations, and if there are something which is left, then I will cover.
One thing, now recent judgment of Delhi High Court, putting aside the faceless.
Yes. There are now many. This is not the last one. There are a series of six decisions of Delhi High Court. Prior to that, there is a Madras High Court also.
Ultimately,
in the matter of assessment, you have to see that by going for a rate, ultimately, what do you get in return? That also has to be assessed. Except that the demand now gets evaporated for the time being, but then no High Court quashes the assessment once for all. And that cannot be done either. So it is only a temporary relief. And therefore, one has to assess now whether by going by way of a writ to the High Court, if any long lasting relief, I mean, can be procured from the High Court. So, I mean, that is beside the point. But then I'll request Somil to kindly start his deliberations.
Okay. Welcome.
Thank you, sir. My guru, Rakesh sir, respected Ashok Sharma sir, Raman sir, Rajesh sir, Arun sir, Ashok Gupta sir, seniors in the profession, and my very dear professional colleagues. Penalty under Section 270 capital A was brought on statute from Assessment Year 1718. Penalty for underreporting of income and misreporting of income. The primary concept, the backbone of this provision is that there is underreported income. Sir, the earlier regime of 270(11)(c), which was wherein we had penalty for furnishing inaccurate particulars of income or concealment of particulars of income, wherein we had two charges. A lot of litigation, number of times, technical, hyper-technical, super-technical issues on legal ground, technical grounds have led to deletion of penalties even in cases which otherwise penalty was or could have been levied on merit. So to do away with this dual charges, which were there in the earlier regime, 270 capital A with the concept of penalty for underreported income has been brought on statute. I'll just bring the section in front. the authorities which were earlier there in 270(11c) are the same who have the jurisdiction to levy penalty under section 270 capital A. The assessing officer would be levying penalty in respect of the underreported income found during the course of assessment. As far as the CIT appeal is concerned, the enhancements which are made by the CIT appeal by exercising power under section 251, qua such income, qua such enhancements, the penalty which lead to underreported income, the penalty would be levied by the appellate authority. Similarly, the principal commissioner or commissioner, while exercising their powers under section 263, if they make any addition in their by revising the assessment order, then qua such enhancement, qua such addition which they make in the 263 order, penalty will be levied by the commissioner or principal commissioner. So these are the authorities who have the jurisdiction to levy penalty for underreported income. Now 270 capital A subsection 1, the emphasis is that the underreported income, if it is there, then the penalty under section 270 capital A can be levied. Now, underreported income, sir, has been defined with the help of numerous situations under subsection 2 and 3, the person who would be considered to have underreported income, or what is underreported income, has been defined under subsection 2 and 3 of section 270 capital A, with various situations as that, as if whether return has been filed or not, earlier assessment made or not, income processed under 143(1A), loss cases. So multiple situations have been envisaged, and accordingly underreported income has been defined. But to put it simply, sir, underreported income is basically the total additions and disallowance which are made in the assessment order, which have led to the variation between the income processed and the income assessed. Say, for example, assessee has filed return of say 10 lakh rupees and ESIPF disallowance has been made under 143(1) of rupees 3 lakh, and accordingly the assessed, the processed income after 143(1) is 13 lakh rupees. Now, assessing officer, while making the assessment, has made two addition, and the assessment has been made at rupees 20 lakh. So the underreported income under section 270 capital A is 20 lakh minus 13 lakh. That is 7 lakh only. That is the underreported income for the purpose of 270 capital A. The adjustments which are made under 143(1) that have been kept out of the purview of penalty under section 270 capital A. Basically, whatever adjustments are made under 143(1), no penalty can be levied on such adjustments. Although this seems quite strange, but probably the reason behind it seems to be that something which is so apparent from record, something which is for which all material is available, it is an apparent adjustment which is available, which is based on the material furnished on record. So therefore, there has no penalty under section 270 capital A has been will be levied for on such adjustments. So, sir, the processed income and the assessed income, the difference, the addition, deletions, disallowances in totality would be denoted as your as the underreported income in the cases. Now, underreported income in consequence of misreporting of income has been provided under subsection 8. And what are those situations wherein the underreported income would be said to be in consequence of misreporting of income? There are six clauses which have been provided under subsection 9, which we'll discuss a little later. So if it is a case of only underreported income, then the penalty leviable would be 50% of the tax payable on the underreported income. Whereas if the assessing officer makes out a case of underreported income in consequence of misreporting of income, then penalty would be levied at the rate of 200% of the tax payable on such underreported income. So in, ultimately, in both the cases, there has to be under-reported income. So until and unless there is variation between the processed income and the assessed income, and which leads to the under-reported income, then only.
Ashok Sharma sir, जरा बंद कर लें please.
मेरा बोला है.
So, and for the purpose of Levy 270 capital A, the existence of under-reported income has to be there, and that is only there if there is additional disallowances, which leads to difference between the income processed and income assessed. So, whatever addition disallowance made by the assessing officer in the assessment order, which has led to the variation, is your under-reported income. Now, sir, assessing officer has made additions and disallowances, which has led to variation. Now, the first endeavor on receipt of the notice under 270 capital initiation penalty, and the first endeavor would be to reduce, to mitigate the exposure of penalty. And the first area is that how we can reduce the very underreported income itself. For that, the mechanism is given under subsection 6 of 270 capital A, which provides 5 clauses. And if assessee is able to, the onus is on the assessee that the addition or disallowance in question is covered under any of these 5 clauses. The burden is on the assessee. And if the assessee is able to prove that yes, clause A, B, C, or out of any of these clauses is applicable in respect of an addition or disallowance, then such addition or disallowance shall not be included in the underreported income. Now, what are these clauses and how we can reduce the exposure of underreported income for the purpose of mitigating the risk of penalty under section 270 capital A? Sir, clause A, where the assessee offers an explanation, and the explanation to the satisfaction of the AO is bona fide, and assessee has disclosed all material facts to substantiate the explanation. Now, sir, this clause A reminds me of explanation 1 capital B in the earlier regime of 270(11c). The similar concept that if the assessee is able to show that yes, assessee has offered an explanation, the explanation is bona fide to the satisfaction of the assessing officer, and all material facts have been disclosed which substantiate the explanation so offered by the assessee, then the addition or disallowance so made can be covered under clause A, and it can be argued, okay, sir, the 3 ingredients of clause A have been fulfilled, and accordingly, there is no case, the so-called addition should be reduced from the underreported income. And since it is reduced from underreported income, there is no case of levy of penalty under section 270 capital A. Sir, clause B. Now, clause B is a situation regarding estimate, as Ashok Sharma sir was also referring to it, that where an addition is made on the basis of estimate, but the requirement is that the accounts are correct and complete to the satisfaction of the assessing officer. So he is not disputing the accounts, the correctness of it. So the question arises, then why is the addition made? So in cases where the addition is being made, or for the reason that the method employed is such that the income cannot be deduced properly, and because of that, the assessing officer has made an estimate, then in such cases, clause B can be argued. And it can be said, sir, my accounts are correct and complete, and there is no dispute on that. It is only an estimate. For the reason that the method employed is not correct as per the assessing officer, and therefore, my case is covered under clause B. Sir, so for example, stock valuations. Assessee is applied, say, LIFO method. AO says, no, the conduct of the business is such, weighted average method will be a better method to apply. And if he makes the addition on this estimation based on the change in method, however, he does not dispute the correct and completeness of the accounts, then even if addition is made, clause B can be argued, and it can be said that such addition, even if made, shall be excluded out of from the underreported income. Now, sir, the another scenario of estimate is covered in clause C. But this is a situation where initially some estimation, some addition or disallowance should have been made by the assessee in the computation of income filed with the return of income. And if that is the case, that the assessee himself has made some disallowance, which has been announced by the assessing officer, and if the assessee has disclosed all material facts relating to the addition or disallowance in question, then clause C can be argued and amount can be excluded from the underreported income. So for example, disallowance is on account of personal expenses. Now, say for example, SSE has disallowed 5%. AO says, no, no, your estimation is on a lower side. It should be 15%. And he makes the enhanced disallowance. So in such cases, if the SSE is able to prove all these three criteria, number one, yes, I have made the disallowance suo motu in the computation. Second, all material facts have been disclosed. And it is only enhancement of an estimate. Then clause C can be argued and such addition or disallowance would be out of the underreported income. Now, sir, clause D, this is applicable in case of transfer pricing adjustments. Now, that prior to that, in case of estimates, now two situations we have seen are covered under clause B and C. These are specific situations. One where assessee suo motu must have disallowed, the other that account should be correct and complete to the satisfaction. It is only change of method. But there can be situations where no disallowance was made by the assessee. Say, for example, disallowance has been made out of business promotion expenses on ad hoc basis, on an estimate. So for such cases of estimates, which are not covered under specific clauses of B and C, clause A would have to be argued. So as we see it forward, the other two clauses, we can see that clause A is the widest and the broadest defense available. What the other four clauses are specific, but whatever defense, if not available in the other four clauses, in any case, the case can be made out under clause A, as we just discussed. Coming back to clause D, sir, in case of transfer pricing adjustments say on account of new filters being applied by the TPO or new comparables being added by the TPO. But if the assessee is able to show that, sir, the documentation has been maintained as required under section 92D, that is as per rule 10D, that the transaction has been reported under form in the form 3CEB, and the assessee has disclosed all material facts relating to the transaction, then if these three criteria are fulfilled, even if the adjustment is made, still such adjustment addition can be excluded from the underreported income under clause D of the subsection 270 capital A. Now, sir, clause E, this is more of an exclusion, which provides that the undisclosed income as referred under section 271AAB, 271AAB is applicable for specified previous years, which is generally the search year and the year before that for which due date for filing return has not expired. And the undisclosed income, which is defined in that section, that is income which is represented by any money, bullion, jewelry, article, document, or other books of account information, which is found during course of search, which is not recorded in the books. So if such undisclosed income is there, which has been referred in 271AAB, qua such amount, since there is a specific provision of 271AAB, penalty under 270 capital A cannot be levied. But sir, one point which I want to highlight here is this, that search year or the year before that, these are abated assessments. That is, the whole gamut of assessment can be is available to the assessing officer, and the addition or disallowance which can be made in this assessment are not limited to any incriminating material which is found during the course of search. Such requirement is there in the case of completed assessment as held by Honorable Delhi High Court in the case of Kabul Chawla 380 ITR page 573. However, these specified previous years, these are generally the years where abated assessment is there. And the complete assessment is available to the assessing officer. So, sir, in such cases, there can be additions. Say, for example, 14 capital A disallowance. For example, 40 AIA disallowance. 43B disallowance. 40A3 disallowance. So, which are dehors any incriminating material which has been found during the course of search. So, in such cases, penalty, if any, has to be levied under section 270 capital A. So, with respect to these specified years, qua undisclosed income 271 double AB and qua income which is not represented by any incriminating material found during search, then 270 capital A penalty can be levied. And accordingly, the defense mechanism, as we just discussed, under clause ABCD is available to mitigate, to reduce the incidence of underreported income. Now, sir, in the earlier regime of 270(11C), the minimum penalty was 100% and which could have been levied up to 300% by the assessing officer. And that discretion was available with the assessing officer. Now, if the assessing officer decided to levy 150%, 200%, 300%, then the judicial precedents had held that the assessing officer, while levying a penalty more than the minimum amount, there has to be some additional justification for that. It has to be by way of a speaking order why he is levying a penalty more than the minimum penalty. Now, sir, in this regime of 270 capital A, either it is 50% with respect to the underreported income, simpliciter. And if the assessing officer is making out a case of underreported income in consequence of any misreporting, then it would be flat 200%. There is no discretion available as was there in the earlier regime. So after using the defense mechanism of subsection 6, even if there is some addition is left out, which could not be made part of the five clauses, then 50% is the penalty of the tax payable which would be levied, subject to if it is made a case of misreporting of income. Now, sir, in coming to misreporting of income, in any case, whether it is a case of underreported income simpliciter or it is underreported income in consequence of misreporting of income, which is defined by way of six situations which are envisaged in the subsection 9. Ultimately, in any case, it remains underreported income. And therefore, unless there is underreported income, there may be that yes, on facts, there may be misreporting, but there may be situations where there is no underreported income which arises, which I'll discuss in the examples when we go through the subsection 9. So the emphasis which I want to lay here is that there has to be underreported income in existence for the purpose of levying penalty under 270 capital A. Sir, in the earlier regime, in 270(11C), say for example, assessee has offered some amount as sales in the books of account and offered to tax, which is taxed at 30%. Now, assessing officer says it should be taxed under 115 BBE under section 68 since these are bogus. These are undisclosed. These are income from undisclosed sources. Now, if that is the situation, under the earlier regime, the charges were that penalty for concealment of particulars of income or concealment for or for furnishing inaccurate particulars of income. One can argue, okay, sir, taxes have been paid. There would not be any tax sought to be evaded for that matter. So, sir, if we put in the aspects, the facts of this case in the definition of tax sought to be vetted, you would see that there is existence of tax fraud to be vetted, because the emphasis of the earlier regime was on the particulars, furnishing inaccurate particulars, concealment of particulars, whereas in the new regime it is about income. So it is, I may have offered it as a lower rate of taxation, but the income has been offered. So even if he may tax it at a higher rate, but since there will not be any difference between the income processed and the income assessed, there will be no underreported income. So in 270 capital A, change of head or inaccurate particulars will not lead to levy of penalty. There has to be existence of underreported income. So, sir, coming to the six clauses which are given in subsection 9. Now, these subsection 9, to make out a case of misreporting of income, the burden lies on the assessing officer. So you would recall explanation 1 capital A in the under section 270(1)(1)(c), which provided and which was held by in judicial decisions, settled law, that to prove that the material facts which are relevant for the computation of income given by the SAC are false, rested on the shoulders of the assessing officer. So on the same concept, to make out a case of misreporting under any of these six clauses, the burden, the onus, is on the shoulders of the assessing officer, who has to pass a speaking order that why and under which clause he's making out a case of misreporting of income. And that too, he has to confront that why he's making out which clause he's activating. He has to give a proper opportunity for that purpose. And accordingly, it has to be show cause. Sir, these clauses are overlapping in nature, but hardly there would be, and they are exhaustive also, but hardly there would be any case which would not be covered under these clauses. Now, coming to the first clause, misrepresentation or suppression of facts. Now, to some extent, this reminds me of the earlier charges: misrepresentation, furnishing of inaccurate particulars, and suppression is concealment, and that too with respect to facts. So if there is any misrepresentation or suppression of fact which has led to underreported income, then obviously it would be a case of levy of penalty at the rate of 200%. Now, sir, let's take an example. A private limited company advances money to the shareholder who has more than 10% of the voting rights. Now, if that is the case, and there are sufficient accumulated profits available, and therefore 222E could be attracted. Now, this SAC company, seeing this concern, has decided to camouflage the transaction and accordingly did not disclose any dividend, and has camouflaged this transaction as a transaction of commercial expediency. The assessing officer during course of assessment asks, all right, kindly prove your commercial expediency, and which assessee miserably fails. Now, in such cases, sir, even if there is a case of misrepresentation, the addition, as held by Honorable Supreme Court in Madhuram Housing, Ankitech judgment, universal, the number of judgments which I have held, that in 222 subclause E, the addition would be made in the hands of the registered shareholder. So if that is the case, that the addition will be made in the hands of the registered shareholder, there is no addition in the hands of the company. And if there is no addition, despite such misrepresentation, there is no underreported income. And even if there is misreporting, there is no income arising out of it. And accordingly, there could not be any case of levy of penalty under subsection 9. Under section 270 capital A. Sir, clause B, to my mind, as on date is irrelevant. And that I say for the reason that failure to record investment in the books of accounts. Now, the question I'm asking to myself is this, that in such cases, if there is investment which I fail to record, the addition, if any, could be made under Section 69. Now, by Taxation Law Second Amendment Act 2016, brought in December 2016, 115 BB tax rate was increased to 60%. A new regime, new penalty provision 271AAC was introduced, wherein it has been specifically provided that penalty with respect to additions which are subject to tax under Section 115 BBE would be levied under Section 271AAC. So when there is a specific provision for such additions, 270A penalty cannot be levied. This is a omission which would be rectified, and for that the reason I find is that this provision 270A was brought by Finance Act 16 and 271AAC was brought in December 16, and therefore it is nothing but a case of omission and which in times to come would be rectified. It is a gloss over lapse which would be rectified. Now clause C, sir, any expenditure which is made by the SAC, and if it has not been substantiated, then obviously clause C would be triggered by the assessing officer to levy penalty at the rate of 200%. Now, sir, say in case of an assessee who is an eligible unit having 100% reduction of the profits. Now, in case of such assessee, while making the assessment, the assessing officer has made some deduction, some disallowances. Say 14A, 40A3, 40AA. Now, these disallowances which have been made, the expenditure which has been disallowed, which could not have been substantiated by the SAC, this expenditure will go on to increase the profits of the eligible unit. However, since reduction is available, 100% reduction is available, therefore, there will not be any income or addition which will lead to variation, which will lead to creation of the underreported income. And since there is no underreported income, there will not be any case of levy of penalty under Section 270A. Coming to clause D, sir, recording of any false entry in the books of accounts. Now, when seeing this clause D, as Ashok sir mentioned in his initial remarks, that 271AAD is also a penalty which has come into the statute by Finance Act 2020, which is penalty for fake invoices, false invoices, penalty for using fake and false invoices documents. Now the question arises that if there is any false entry, recording of any false entry, 270A subsection 9 clause D covers it and levies penalty at 200%. And 271AAD also for any false entry, for fake invoices, penalty is leviable under 271AAD of the amount of such false entry. So is it a case of double jeopardy? So sir, my humble submission here is this, that 271AAD is a penalty for the very act of using those fake invoices, those false documents. As sir mentioned in the initial remarks, that penalty has an effect of deterrence. So 271AAD comes as a deterrence to the very act of using those invoices in the books of accounts. Whereas 270A is for the underreported income, that the income which has been underreported, which is a consequence of using those false invoices. So you have underreported the income, the SAC has underreported the income, that is one default, and the very fact that the SAC used fake and false invoices to levy penalty in the books of accounts, that is an act, that is a default which is being penalized under 271AAD. Sir, with utmost respect, this is not the first provision which has come, which is divorce any income being sought to tax on which penalty will be levied, 271D for that matter, 271E for that matter. Even if there is no addition or disallowance, there is no underreported income, still for acceptance or repayment of loans, in violation of 270 in violation of the 269 SST NST. So these penalties can be levied. So these are two independent defaults which are being captured by two independent provisions. And in my humble submission, there is no case of double jeopardy. And accordingly, penalty under both the provisions, if found on the substantiated by the assessing officer as onus in both the cases, primarily the burden would lie on the assessing officer. And would lie on the assessing officer. And if he's able to substantiate, then penalty under both the provisions can be levied. Coming to clause E, sir, failure to record any books of accounts having a bearing on total income. So, quite surprisingly, now this very clause has been qualified having a bearing on total income. But it, as we discussed, until and unless there is some underreported income, and that will arise only if the addition or disallowance will have bearing on the income, will have variation from my process to assessed. So probably seeing an overcautious approach, this was qualified, or probably for the reason that received word has been used, which may be capital or revenue. So they thought it wise to qualify having a bearing on total income. But in my humble submission, in all the clauses, there has to be a bearing on total income, which leads to underreported income. So if some out of book sales are found, which have not been recorded in the books of accounts, then clause E, penalty at 200% can be levied. Sir, clause F, failure to report any international transaction or specified domestic transactions, then obviously, now the defense mechanism which we saw in subsection 6, that provides that the assessee must have reported the transaction. Now, if at the outset, assessee has failed to report, then the assessing officer will make out a case of clause F that, look, sir, it is a case of underreported income in consequence of misreporting of income. But sir, the question I'm asking here is this, that if the assessee, say, has failed to report the transaction, but once the transaction comes to light, comes to the information of the assessing officer, and he has referred the matter to TPO, and who has examined the transaction, and the transaction is at arm's length price, there is no adjustment to it. Now, when there is no adjustment, there is no addition. Obviously, there is failure to report. But since there is no income, which is arising, there is no underreported income, and therefore, there is no case of levy of penalty under section 270 capital A. Although 271 double A for non-reporting of transaction, that would be levied on the basis of facts. But 270 capital A, in absence of any underreported income, cannot be levied. Now, sir, while dealing with the penalty notices, as we discussed, the first endeavor would be that subsection 6 defense. That has to be used to the maximum extent possible. If the case is covered under any of the specific four clauses, clause B, C, D, E, then obviously on the basis of facts and establishing those bringing out our case in those clauses by proper application with supported with evidences has to be filed. Now, sir, penalty notices are being received with the assessment orders. Generally, as a matter of practice, initially we reply, sir, we are filing an appeal. We have filed an appeal to the first appellate authority, and therefore this penalty proceeding may be kept in abeyance. And as a matter of practice, generally we have seen that the assessing officers keep the penalty in abeyance. But if the first appellate authority has confirmed the addition, then the assessing officer issues again, a show cause that why the penalty should not be levied. In such cases, sir, we can file the letter again. Okay, sir, the penalty may be kept in abeyance. But sir, my humble submission here is this, that although they have the power that till the disposal of appeal by the second appellate authority, that is the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, they can keep the penalty in abeyance. But probably some internal instructions, they generally don't keep the penalty in abeyance. And therefore, as sir mentioned in the initial remarks also, the notices which are as of now being received either after the first after the order of the first appellate authority, after confirmation of the additions, the notices are being received, or these notices which are received with the assessing officer are being received. Obviously, we can in any case request that the penalty may be kept in abeyance, but with that we should make out our case on merits, on facts. Yes, sir. Under subsection 6, these are the defense mechanism, and this is the clause in which, on the basis of our the facts of our case, the penalty cannot be levied. Sir, there are situations, there can be compulsion, there can be certain cases where evidences which could have been or should have been placed in the assessment proceedings before the assessing officer. And as a student of law, and the law of pleading provides that the evidences on facts, the pleadings on facts should be placed before the court of original jurisdiction, that is before the assessing officer in the assessment proceedings. However, still if some evidences, which may be due to paucity, due to inadequate opportunity, maybe due to that the evidences were not available, are now available, which could not be placed earlier, are now available. So even these evidences should be placed with the penalty proceeding replies. Sir, the hurdle that we have while getting the additional evidences admitted in the first appellate forum, that is under Rule 46 capital A, the conditions which are required therein to be complied with, that hurdle is not there while filing evidences in the penalty proceedings. So even if the evidences which could not be placed before the assessing officer during the assessment proceedings can be very well placed before the penalty, before the officer in the penalty proceedings, and the matter can be argued, then the addition itself cannot be made. And a classic example of this scenario situation is the order of Honorable Supreme Court, which was which is dated 24th April 2020, in the case of Bashir Ahmed Sisodia. Now, in that case, assessee was called upon to justify, to confirm the creditors, the genuineness of the creditors in the assessment proceeding, which the assessee failed to bring evidences on record. And on verification by the AO, the creditors could not be verified. First appellate forum, against the assessment order, addition was confirmed. Second, tribunal confirmed the addition. Honorable High Court confirmed the addition, and the matter was pending before the Honorable Supreme Court. Meanwhile, penalty was levied. And in the appeal against penalty order to the first appellate authority, the assessee was finally able to get in touch with the creditors. Their fresh confirmation were brought on the statute, on the record, by way of admission of additional evidences. Statements were recorded in the remand proceedings, in the penalty proceedings, appellate proceedings. And on the basis of those findings, the CIT appeal and penalty appeal deleted the penalty on the basis of these evidences. And the department did not file appeal to the tribunal. Now, this CIT appeal's order with the evidences was brought on record before the Honorable Supreme Court in the quantum proceedings. The Honorable Supreme Court, seeing the findings, which may be that stark, that they decided not to remit the matter back in view of the new evidences, then and there deleted the addition itself. And therefore, even in the penalty proceedings, the assessee is very well, it is very well open to the assessee to prove, to show, even by way of new fresh evidences, that the addition itself cannot be made. Sir, assessment proceedings and penalty proceedings are two independent proceedings. The conclusions, the findings in the assessment order are important, are relevant. There is no doubt about that. But they are not conclusive. And the penalty proceedings, being an independent proceedings, the assessee can lead the evidence that the addition itself is bad in law. Now, sir, before the last point which I want to take up is section 270 AA.
Actually, Swamiji, There is one question is there in Q&A section. Can additions under section 14 be treated as underreported where calculation was provided by the SSC? There was no borrowed money and any interest paid by the company.
Sir, in such cases, to my mind, 14A disallowance, which is based as per Rule 8D, will not be covered under Clause B or C. But yes, a SSC can very well make out a case under Clause A that the explanation was bona fide. The SSC has substantiated the explanation, which is to the satisfaction of the assessing officer, and accordingly, penalty under 270 capital A can be argued that it cannot be levied. But the clauses of estimation, since 14A is being driven, the disallowance is driven by a Rule 8D, which is a specific formula, and if it is made as per that only, then it will not be covered under specific provisions. But Clause A, in any case, is available as a defense mechanism. So the last provision which I wanted to discuss is 270AA. Now, at the outset, 270AA is available only in cases for immunity from penalty in respect of simpliciter underreported income. If the penalty is initiated in the assessment order for underreported income in consequence of misreporting of income, then 270AA is not available. Immunity is not available. Now, the requirement is that the tax and interest should be paid up to the date specified in the demand notice. No appeal should be filed, and the application for immunity should be filed within 1 month from the receiving of the assessment order. The form is Form 68 and Rule is 129. It is a one-page form, and on receipt of the application, the assessing officer may accept or reject, but he has to pass a speaking order. And in case he rejects, he has to give an opportunity of hearing to the assessee. And if he rejects the application, then the only route available is the writ remedy. There is no appeal for that mechanism. Now, sir, one more penalty notice, which is as on date being issued, and that is under section 272A, subsection 1, clause D, where there is failure to comply with any 142.1 or 143.2 notice or direction under 142.2 capital A. So, sir, if such notice is received for any such failure, so by preparing a reply, while dealing with such notices, the first and foremost, our endeavor should be to verify the facts. Number one, which failure he is making a charge, for which default is the notice issued, whether that fact that the default had taken place is correct or not, and then what was the reason for such non-compliance. And once we have this reason for non-compliance, which is a reasonable cause, then our endeavor should be to use the defense mechanism that is available under section 273 capital B, which provides that no penalty, inter alia, one of the provisions that this clause D of 272A subsection 1 is covered there, and which provides that no penalty would be levied if there is a reasonable cause for the failure. So that reasonable cause, obviously, essentially is a question of fact, and one has to, while making an application, not only the cause has to be written, it should be substantiated by direct documentary and circumstantial evidences. And accordingly, a speaking application has to be placed that, sir, if this is a case of failure, even if this failure was made, this non-compliance was due to a reasonable cause, and which is this, and which is substantiated by so-and-so evidences. And accordingly, 273B, the defense should always be used in such cases of issuance of notice under section 272A1D. Sir, with this, I'll conclude my deliberation. I thank you all for the patient hearing.
One question is there, that is by Ayush Kumar. What if tax has been paid within 30 days, but application is not submitted within 1 month? Any possibility of condonation of delay?
Sir, the statute does not provide for any delay condonation. It is, and probably there is no discretion also with the assessing officer for that matter. Strict. This is a strict provision, has to be adhered as per the provisions of the Act, 270AA.
Thank you, Somil ji.
Somil ji, where you are? Chat box mein upar hi upar thi. Ram ji, ek minute.
Sir, agar sahi lagta ho, to last mein le le queries.
Haan, sir, actually, sir, aapka ye topic hai na, uske saath hi ho jata hai, to थोड़ा अच्छा अंडरस्टैंड हो जाता है
सर, जैसे जैसे सही लगे सर। जी
एक चैट बॉक्स में छोटी सी क्वेरी आई थी, इस पेनल्टी अंडर सेक्शन 271 डबल ए बी कैपिटल डबल ए बी इज कंपलसरी।
सर कंपलसरी तो कोई पेनल्टी नहीं होती, इट विल डिपेंड ऑन द फैक्ट्स ऑफ द केस एंड इफ द केस द फैक्ट्स जस्टिफाई देन इट कैन बी लेविड, फैक्ट्स डोंट जस्टिफाई इफ यू आर एबल टू मेक आउट अ केस इन दैट प्रोविजन दैट either it is not undisclosed income or either it is not a case of levy of penalty under the four corners of that provision, then penalty cannot be levied. So it depends on the facts of the case. There is no compulsion there.
No, probably the question is this, that whether 271 double AD penalty, probably that was the section which has been wrongly mentioned, 271 double AB. Is it 271 double AB, Arunji, or 271 double AD?
B, I think B.
Double AB likha sir.
Okay, double AB. So, double AB penalty is dependent upon two facts. Number one, whether there is undisclosed income and whether there is, this undisclosed income is of the previous year, the specified previous year. And then if there are any of these conditions which are there under 271 double AB is not fulfilled, that you have not declared it in 132.4 statement, when you have not specified the manner of earning that undisclosed income, you have not substantiated the manner, you have not paid the tax in time, and you have not filed the return, then the penalty is leviable. But then, of course, opportunity of hearing would be given to you. You can make out a case that none of these ingredients have you fall in, and therefore the penalty should not be levied. Okay, now let me begin. Ramanji?
Ramanji?
Yes, sir. Please.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. So I will pick up the cue from the penalty where Swamil has left, and then we'll take up certain issues which Ashok Sharmaji has raised on mens rea. Mens rea is the mental involvement, the mental culpability. Now, that is not essential for the departmental authorities to establish the mental culpability. And even in the context of section 2711C, the Supreme Court had said it finally in Dharmendra Textiles and all those decisions that mens rea is not essential. But if you read the section 2711C, then it used to say that if the where the SSE has concealed the particulars of income or furnished inaccurate particulars of income. So even if the mens rea is not there, but then if we go by the dictionary meaning of the word concealment, some intent, some malafide intent now is already built into the meaning of the word concealment, because concealment is what? To withhold, and to withhold with some purpose, with some intent. So even if the courts have said that mens rea is not required to be established by the departmental authority, but under the old provision of section 2711C, that intent was inbuilt into the plain meaning of the word concealment or furnishing inaccurate particulars. And therefore, at that stage, it used to be seen whether it was a bona fide or it was an act of mala fide. And therefore, it has got some role to play under the erstwhile provision of section 2711C. But under section 270 capital A, I mean, the things have been made simpler. Now, whether there is a difference between the assessed income and the processed income or not. And if there is difference, then it is underreported income. And if it is underreported income, as Swamil has spelled out, that under clause small a of subsection 6, if you can say that you have furnished an explanation, explanation is bona fide, you have disclosed all facts to substantiate your explanation, then the penalty will not be imposed, because then it will not form part of underreported income. In respect of the misreporting of income, so far as the first clause is concerned, misrepresentation or suppression, then mental culpability has to be established by the assessing officer. Because misreporting, suppression also is equivalent to, as Swamil has spelled out, to concealment. Therefore, even if mens rea is often said to be not proved by the departmental authority, but then it has got its own implicit role at some stage. Now 271AA and 270A, Ashok Sharma ji raised this issue that how can there be penalty for one and the same default? Though Somil has dealt with that there can be or there cannot be said to be the same defaults or the penalty for the same defaults. And this penalty, these two penalties are the different defaults. But then be that as it may, even if there is a penalty for one and the same default under two different sections, then also it is permissible. Now there is no such constitutional mandate in the matter of penalty that there cannot be, I mean, two penalties for one and the same default. There cannot be two conviction or sentence under the criminal law, but then there cannot be any bar or prohibition for not levying two penalties for one and the same default if the legislature has so provided. And in any case, section 271AAD starts with the non-obstante clause, or not non-obstante, but then without prejudice. It says, notwithstanding, I mean, without prejudice to any other consequence. So 271AAD starts with that kind of a phraseology, that without prejudice to any other provisions, meaning thereby that if there is some other consequence for this very act elsewhere under the Income Tax Act, then this penalty is in addition to that consequence. So the legislature in its wisdom has enacted it, then is enacted it. Regarding the estimated income, Somil has very nicely dealt with. So now regarding the other penalties, so though Somil has briefly touched upon, but then there can be whole hosts of penalty. There can be penalty under section 221 if a person or if an SSE is held to be an SSE in default for not paying the tax in time or for not depositing the tax collected at source or deducted at source in time. There can be penalty for non-maintenance of books of account. There can be penalty for not retaining the books of account. There can be penalty for not getting the books of accounts audited. There can be penalty for non-deduction of tax at source or tax collection at source. There can be penalty for accepting loan or deposit otherwise than through the banking channel. There can be penalty for repayment of loan or deposit otherwise than through the banking channel. So there are whole hosts of penalty, and they are divorced or divorced from the assessment. Therefore, in all such kind of penalty situations, then one will have to see, first of all, that if at all the default as contemplated under these respective sections has been committed at all by the SSE or not. So if that default has not been committed by the SSE, or the default contemplated under these sections for which the penalty notices have been served has been committed by the SSE, then the SSE must come forward and then say, not only to say, but then prove it. But then most of the situations would you find that where the defaults have been committed. So in such a situation, as Somil has very rightly pointed out, that there is a very strong defense mechanism provided under section 273 capital B of the Income Tax Act, which says that no penalty shall be imposed if it is established by that person, by the SSE, that there was a reasonable cause. So penalty is not automatic, because somebody asked whether the penalty is mandatory. Penalty is not mandatory. Penalty is not automatic. But then, of course, the default, when the default is there and there is no reasonable cause, then the penalty can be imposed, but then that too after giving you an opportunity of being heard and seeking your explanation. So penalty is not a natural consequence of any addition or a natural consequence of any default. You will be put on notice. In the matter of other penalties, then you can very well explain the reasonable cause. And therefore, I always urge and would urge even today that while giving replies to penalty notices, if the default is found to have been committed by SSE, then find out the cause for the default. Turn that default into the reasonable cause, turn that cause into the reasonable cause, and put that reasonable cause as a defense, and substantiate and establish with evidence that reasonable cause. I have seen that many of my chartered accountants' friend now either do not advance the reasonable cause despite there being reasonable cause, and even if it is advanced, then it is not established with evidence. And thereby, in that process, causing a grave injury for the case of our client. So this aspect has to be taken care of, since I have to speak on penalty in a very peripheral manner. Therefore, I am not covering that aspect in a comprehensive manner. And I will see, I mean, on some other occasion to deal with this issue. So now after this, I will come to the presumptive scheme of taxation, I mean, which is the main topic which has been given to me by Shri Arun Gupta ji. Now, presumptive scheme of taxation was introduced for the purpose of bringing an element of simplification in the taxation system. That if you have got this much of receipts, then we will assume that this much to be your income. You pay tax, you be happy, and we are happy. And with that kind of the philosophy, these presumptive taxation sections have come on the statute. And which are those sections? Mainly 44AD, 44ADA, 44AE. Though there are other sections also, 40B, BB, BBB, but then since they are relating to the international transactions, therefore we are not discussing them. So 44AD, 44AE, ADA is applicable on the professionals. AE is applicable in this in respect of those persons who are engaged in the business of plying, leasing, or running vehicles on hire. And 44AD is applicable in case of almost all other business, certain exceptions. So since we all are chartered accountants, professionals, and therefore it will be apt, appropriate, and relevant to start my deliberations by picking up section 44ADA, which is applicable in case of the professionals. I need not to speak on the plain provisions of law, because my audience is well-informed audience. 44ADA is applicable in case of individual and partnership firms who are carrying on professions, and their gross receipts from the profession does not exceed 50 lakhs of rupees. And then in such a situation, if they declare 50% of the gross professional receipts or such higher amount as they claim to have earned from the profession, and that will be deemed to be the income from profession for the previous year. This is the plain provision. So now I'll speak on the issues. So the first issue which I'll take in case of the professionals, or for that matter section 44ADA, is that whether it is applicable to all professionals across the board, or there are some professionals who are not covered within the ambit of section 44ADA, even if their receipts are not more than 50 lakhs or rupees. So if we read the definition of the profession, and obviously a person who is carrying on the profession, then it's professional. And therefore, if we read the definition of profession as given under the Income Tax Act, it says the profession includes vocation. Now it leads us nowhere. It doesn't say as to what is the meaning of profession, because profession's meaning is as clear as the daylight. Some specialized knowledge backed with experience, and which is regulated by some body or some regulations. But then since profession includes vocation, and the vocation may or may not be regulated by any established body, so there may well be the vocations which are considered to be the professions. Therefore, we have to see the professions in that light. Now, 44ADA is applicable only to those professions which are referred under subsection 1 of section 44ADA, meaning thereby that those professions which are not so referred under subsection 1 of section 44AA are the professions now who cannot claim the benefit of presumptive scheme under section 44ADA. So profession which are prescribed under subsection 1 of section 44A, legal, engineering, medical, architectural, profession of accountancy, interior decorator, and then such notified professions प्रोफेशन ऑफ कंपनी सेक्रेटरी, प्रोफेशन ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी, फिल्म आर्टिस्ट, ऑथराइज रिप्रेजेंटेटिव. Now, apart from these professions which I have just listed, now any other profession or a person who is pursuing the vocation now is not covered to declare his income under 44 ADA. So let us be clear on this aspect. The second question comes that if there is a professional who is qualified professional in the sense that his profession is a profession under subsection 1 of section 44AA, and if his gross professional receipts are say 50 lakhs or less, now whether will it be mandatory for him to declare his professional income at least at 50%? So though it is not mandatory for him, but then in case he wants to avail the benefit of 44 ADA, then he will have to declare at least 50% of his gross professional receipts as income from the profession. In case he does not want to so declare, or he claims that his income is not equivalent to at least 50% of the professional receipts, and then subject to certain conditions, then he will be required to get his books of accounts audited. So 44 ADA, if a professional wants to avail having gross receipts of 50 lakhs or less, then he will have to declare at least 50% of the receipts as his income from the profession. And in case his income is lesser than this amount, then he may have to get his books of accounts audited. But then the associated with this is a question. Now he declares 50%. So does it mean that whether that professional is not required to maintain books of account? Because subsection 4 says that in case you do not so declare, then you are required to maintain books of account and get them audited. So whether it implies, whether it means that if you are a professional declaring 50% of your professional receipts and professional receipts are not in excess of 50 lakhs of rupees, then you are not required even to maintain books of account. Section 44AA, if we read with rule 6F, then a person carrying on these profession is required to maintain books of account if in preceding 3 previous years, in each year, his professional receipts are more than 1,50,000 rupees. So under 44 ADA, I am talking of a person who was having professional receipts of 50 lakhs, 45 lakhs, 40 lakhs, which is far more than 1,50,000 rupees. So under 44AA rule, read with rule 6F, he is required to maintain books of account. But 44ADA says that you are not required to maintain books of account. Even the board has given one frequently asked questions answer, that in case you are declaring your income at 50%, then you need not to maintain books of account. First of all, whether the frequently asked questions answers can be said to be having any statutory force, because if a circular is issued under section 119 of Income Tax Act, it has got the statutory force. It is enforceable, even if it is contrary to law. But then if it is beneficial for the taxpayers, then such benevolent circulars can be enforced against the department. That is the law. So 44AA read with rule 6F and section 44ADA on the other end, and FAQ reply by the board, I mean, they do not see an eye to eye to each other. And in any case, a prescribed professional is governed by his own, like we are governed by our institute's regulations. Then under those regulations, I mean, we are required to maintain books of account. So far as the maintenance of books of account is concerned, the professional would have to maintain books of account, may not be under the Income Tax Act for the purpose of income tax, but then because of other professional compulsion or regulations. The next issue is, now whether a professional individual, or for that matter professional firm, let us take it as professional firm, now having receipts of 50 lakhs of rupees, I mean, for the purpose of simplifications in the tax computations, I am taking 50 lakhs of professional receipts, but then incurring loss. Now, whether such a professional firm is required to keep its books of accounts maintained and get them audited. Under subsection 4 of section 44 ADA, now it is provided that in case you are an individual or a firm having receipts of rupees 50 lakhs or less, declaring profit less than 50% of the professional receipts, which in this case is because it is incurring loss, then in such a situation, that person is required to not only maintain books of account, but then to get them audited. So if we read this much subsection 4, then this firm may be required to keep books of account and then get them audited. But then there is one more limb of subsection 4 or section 44 ADA, which says, provided the total income is above the basic threshold limit. Now, in case of a firm, the basic threshold limit is zero. Now, it is incurring loss. Loss is less than zero. Therefore, under subsection 4 of section 44 ADA, if a partnership firm having professional receipts of 50 lakhs, but then incurring loss, may not be required to get its books of accounts audited. Even if it may be required to keep the books of accounts because of the professional compulsions or because of professional regulations, but then under subsection 4, it is not required to get them audited because its total income is not above the basic threshold limit. Now, this is something which it's a dichotomy. It is inconsistency. And therefore, but then somebody can say, sir, in profession, there is no question of loss. No, I am not on that aspect. I am discussing a scenario which is probable, which is possible. I mean, we cannot say it's impossible or improbable. So I am talking about the position of law which can be there and which can give, I mean, in such kind of fact situations and which, I mean, defies logic. Now, can a professional having, say, professional receipts of 50 lakhs, I'll keep it at 50 lakhs for the purpose of simplifications computations. Now, he says the section 44 ADA says that I can declare my income at 50% of my professional receipts, say 25 lakhs. But my actual income is, say, 70%, 35 lakhs. But since 44 ADA says that I can declare my income at 50%. So would that be enough? And can I create capital with this amount of rupees 10 lakhs? No. There is no such mandate. It says 50% of the professional receipts or such higher amount as may be claimed to have been earned by this professional. So in case you say that there is a profit of 70%, then you are obliged to declare your income at 70%. But then when you are not in a position to say that you have earned income more than 50%, but then you want to declare at 50% because you do not want to get into that hustle bustle of the books of account and the audit, then that is all right. But then you cannot be heard saying that though you earn 70% of your gross professional receipts as income, but then you will declare only 50% because section 44 ADA says that you can declare your income 50%. So that is clearly not permissible in law. Now, the next issue which I want to touch upon, and some questions have also come on that aspect which Arunji has sent me, and probably when I'll deal this issue, that question, may get answered. The issue is, Now, whether 44 ADA benefit can be availed by a working partner of a professional firm? Now, a working partner of a professional firm can also be or can be only the professional. So, in a chartered accountant's firm, only chartered accountants can be the partner. Therefore, and as a partner, he is pursuing the profession, maybe in the capacity of him being partner of the partnership firm. But nonetheless, he cannot be said to be not carrying on the profession. So, in such a situation, a question comes whether a partner of a professional firm having total receipts by way of remuneration and interest, which is less than 50 lakhs of rupees, can take the advantage of Section 44 ADA by declaring 50% of 50 lakhs, that is 25 lakhs, as his income. And associated with this is the question. Now, in order to see the threshold of 50 lakhs, whether his share of profit from the partnership firm, now whether would be taken into account, would be aggregated, and then it will be seen whether it has exceeded 50 lakhs or not. So these are the two issues. So far as taking up the second question first, since the partner's share of profit is exempt under Section 10, Clause 2, Capital A, and does not enter into the tax arena at all. Therefore, such exempt income or receipt cannot be taken into account for the purpose of determining the threshold of 50 lakhs of rupees. Now, so far, so good. So, answering second question first, professional partner's share of profit will not be aggregated with the amount of salary and interest in order to see whether he crosses the threshold of 50 lakhs or not. Ignore it for this purpose. But then, whether the partner, if at all, can claim the benefit of 44 ADA, now this has come in somewhat cloud. I used to hold this view that the partner can claim the benefit of 44 ADA. But Madras High Court, in the context of Section 44 AD, not in the context of Section 44 ADA, but since if you read the languages of both these sections, I mean, they are somewhat similar, if not identical. Now, in the context of Section 44 AD, now there what happened? And the name of the decision is A. Anand Kumar's decision. And it was a decision of 2020. Now, that partner of that firm said that he wants to avail the benefit of Section 44 AD by declaring his presumptive income at 8% of his salary and interest. High Court said that, first of all, he cannot be said to be carrying on business. Now, again, that is an extreme view, because partnership is nothing but a compendious name of all the partners put together. But for the purpose of Income Tax Act, that is a different matter, that partnership firm and the partners are considered separate taxable entity. Otherwise, under the Partnership Act or under the general law, civil law, partners and partnership firms, I mean, they do not have a separate entity. But then the Madras High Court said, first of all, the partner cannot be said to be carrying on business. Who is carrying on the business? Partnership firm is carrying on the business. So first of all, Madras High Court said this. And second, Madras High Court said that 44 AD contemplates the gross receipts, and therefore salary and interest cannot be said to be the gross receipts for the purpose of Section 44 AD. So if that is the logic and rationale in the case of A. Anand Kumar coming from Madras High Court, and then the same logic can be extrapolated or can be extended in case of the partnership firm also, a partner of a partnership firm also. So subject to that rider, subject to that caveat that there is a decision, though under Section 44 AD given by the Madras High Court, that decision will keep on staring at our face, though that is a non-jurisdictional high court, but then that is the high court. Barring that decision, I hold the view that a partner of a partnership firm, which is a professional firm, according to me, can be said to be carrying on profession, his remuneration as a working partner is nothing but the receipt by him from the profession. And therefore, if it is not in excess of 50 lakhs of rupees, then he should be covered under section 44AD. Now, under section 44AE, now which is applicable in case of a person carrying on the business referred in section 44A, is that of plying, leasing or running them on hire, the goods carriages. That in case, and when if you are not having more than 10 goods carriages at any time during the previous year, then your income will be computed in case you so want as per subsection 2 of section 44A. That in case is heavy goods carriages, then 1000 rupees per ton per month or part of the month during which you owned that heavy goods carriages. In case of any other vehicle, then 7500 per month or part of the month. So the aggregate of these two amounts will constitute your presumptive income under section 44AE. So you have got, say, 44AE income, let us assume 50 lakhs of rupees. Now 44AE subsection 7 says that in case you claim that your profits and gains from this business are less than the profits and gains which is presumed to be there, then you are required to maintain books of accounts and get them audited. So suppose 50 lakhs was your income from, and this is as per subsection 2 of section 44AE, but you have got brought forward losses under section 72, and thereby your total income or your income would then be less than 50 lakhs of rupees, of course, because that will be set off out of 50 lakhs of business income. Suppose if you have got some brought forward losses, or if you have got, say, current year's loss under some other head, then obviously, I mean, that loss will have to be set off in order to compute your income, total income. So What would happen in a case where, though he has declared his income according to the presumptive scheme of section 44AE, but because of some loss under some other head or because of the brought forward loss, his income falls below that presumptive amount of income. Like in this example, his income becomes 48 lakhs, though he declared the income as per 44AE formula. So as per subsection 7, he is not required to maintain books of account and he is not required to get them audited, because subsection 7 says that you would be required to maintain books and get them audited only in that situation when you do not declare the income as per section 44AE presumptive scheme. And this SSC says, since I have declared 50 lakhs of rupees income from vehicles, and therefore, I mean, I am not required. But then if we read section 44AA, which requires such person to maintain books of account, when we read section 44AB, which requires such persons to get their books of accounts audited, then there is a dichotomy. And the dichotomy is what? 44AA clause C says, or clause 3 says, that where the profits and gains from the business are deemed to be the profits and gains of the SSE under section 44AE, like in our case, and the SSE has claimed his income to be lower than the profits and gains so deemed. Now he is claiming in this example that his income is less than that profits and gains from that business. His income is 48 lakhs, which is lower than the profits and gains of 44A business, that is 50 lakhs. Then he is required to keep books of account. So 44A subsection says that he is not required to maintain books of account. But in this example, 44AA clause small 3I says that he is required to books of account. He is required to maintain books of account. And 44AB small c also says the same thing. Therefore, how to reconcile? Because this SSC can say that as per subsection 7, I am not required to maintain books of account. I am not required to get them audited because whatever income was computable under section 44AE, like in this example, 50 lakhs, I have declared it. Therefore, I am not required. But then 44AA and 44AB says that in case his income is lesser than that presumptive scheme, then he is required to maintain books of account. And then he is required to get them audited. So it is a case of dichotomy. And in fact, it seems to be a case of legislature not noticing this distinction. But then going by the rule of literal construction, we all are chartered accountants. If we are confronted with this kind of a situation, let us persuade our client not only to maintain books, but then get them audited. Because by getting them audited through us, there may be, some amount of damages by way of our professional fee. But then tomorrow, in case, if he's called upon to pay penalty for not getting the books of accounts audited, then there may unnecessarily be litigation. Now, 44AD, the first question which comes is, now whether, and most of my chartered accountant friends ask, now if I commence some business and my turnover is less than 2 crores of rupees, now am I bound to declare my income from that business at the rate of 8%? And in case if I do not so declare, whether I am required to maintain books of account and get them audited? So the answer to this question is that 44AD, till the year in which you yourself make a claim, cannot be thrust upon you. So if you have begun your business, your turnover is less than 2 crores of rupees, you do not want to declare your income at 8%, yes, choice is yours. Or for that matter, if your income, if the turnover of your business is less than, say, 1 crore of rupees, and your actual profit comes to, say, somewhere around 5%. Now, department cannot say, assessing officer cannot say, the revenue cannot urge that you ought to have declared your income at the rate of 8% under section 44AD, since you have not so declared it, and therefore you are required to not only maintain books of account, but then to get them audited. No, because 44AD's trigger will come only when in some year you yourself have claimed the benefit of 44AD. Then next 5 years, it may be somewhat incumbent upon you to follow it. But unless you claim it in any year prior to that, the department cannot thrust it on you. And this is evident from the plain reading of subsection 4 of section 44AD, which says, where 44AD subsection 4 says, where an eligible SSC declares profit for any previous year in accordance with the provisions of this section. So the mandate of you following subsequent 5 years under 44AD will come when in any year you yourself have declared your income under 44AD. So in the initial year, initial 2 years, 3 years, or so long as you do not yourself claim in any year the benefit of 44AD, then it cannot be thrust on you. Second, now, if you fall under 44AD, you declare your income under 44.88%. Now, to what extent is your responsibility to establish various facts? Or for every fact, the SSE can say, since I am not maintaining books of account, nor am I required to maintain books of accounts, therefore, you please do not ask me to establish any fact or figure. Can any SSE claim this kind of an immunity? That is the question. So the answer to that question is that since it is you who is claiming the benefit of this presumptive scheme of section 44AD, therefore, to prove at least to this extent that you qualify to be inside section 44AD. Now, that much is on you to prove. So, you will have to prove that you are an eligible SSE. You will have to prove that you are carrying on eligible business. Many assessment orders do come to me. If any bank account is detected, then they say that SSE is carrying on business, which SSE did not disclose initially, but then this is a business. The turnover, which is less than 2 crores, the entire deposit, which is there in the bank account, represents the sale proceeds, which is less than 2 crores. And therefore, I have declared 8%, and therefore, you do not ask anything from me. No. At least, if you are really carrying on business, if at all, you are carrying on the business in order to say that you are carrying on eligible business, that much you are required to prove. Your turnover was not more than 2 crores of rupees, though it is a negative fact, but then you will have to say, and then thereafter it will be for the revenue officer, it will be for the assessing officer in case he disputes your version. But then at least this fact that you qualify to be inside the scope of section 44AD, that much burden is there. Despite you are not required to maintain books of account, you just cannot shrug off. You cannot just wash off your hands by saying, since you are not required to maintain books of account, therefore, please do not ask anything from me. No, you'll have to prove that you are carrying on business. You made sales. You made purchases. Not beyond this. But then if you want to say that even assessing officer cannot ask you that what kind of business am I doing, and assessing officer cannot ask me to prove the carrying on the business itself by asking me to produce some evidence, then I would say that our understanding of law, requires refinement. The next issue which comes, now 8% or more. 8% of what? Turnover of gross receipts. So what is the meaning of turnover? Because 8%, if the turnover is more, then 8% will be more. If the turnover is more, even turnover becomes more than 2 crore, then you will be lock, stock and barrel out from the ambit of section 44AD. Therefore, it is very essential for us to know that turnover would be merely the amount of sales or something else, because your entry into the scope of section 44AD itself would be dependent upon as to what is the quantum of turnover, because eligible business is where the turnover or gross receipts do not exceed with 2 crore. Therefore, if your turnover as per your books of accounts is 1 crore 90 lakhs of rupees, and if GST is loaded on it, say 18%, then it becomes 2 crore 8 lakhs of rupees, 2 crores 8 lakhs, then you will be out. So, whether the turnover would include the tax duty or cess? Of course, yes. For the purpose of determining the turnover threshold of 44AB, if I am following the exclusive method of accounting, tax duty assess may not enter into the computation of turnover for the purpose of determining the turnover threshold for the purpose of tax on it. But for the purpose of determining 8% of that turnover, this turnover must comprise of tax, duty or cess, because section 145 capital A says, 145 capital A says that inventory, purchases, sales would be loaded by the tax, duty or cess for bringing such goods or services to the present location in the present condition. And this is essential for the purpose of determining the profits and gains, income under the head profits and gains of business. That is what it has been said in section 145. And 44 AD is an exercise for determining the income which is to be assessed under that business. Therefore, how can there be turnover in 44 AD without taking into consideration the effect of section 145 capital? Now, turnover would include these tax, duty or cess for the purpose of seeing whether you have crossed the limit of 2 crore or not, number one. In case, even if you have not crossed the limit of 2 crore despite the inclusion of tax, duty or cess, then 8% will have to be calculated with this enhanced base. Now, somebody can say, how do you expect me to pay 8% on the tax, duty or cess? I mean, out of which I have not to earn anything. But then answer to this question would lie into the appreciation of the basic character of these tax, duty or cess. These tax, duty or cess which are imposed is your obligation as a trader to pay, whether you do require it from your customer or you do not require it from customer. Now, recovery of this amount from the customer has been recognized under the law, but then it is an ingrained nature of your turnover. These excise duty, these GST, these are part of your turnover. Now, this exclusive method of accounting or inclusive method of accounting, now these are the accountancy terminologies or accountancy methods, and it is settled law that the true character of an income cannot be different by using a different accounting or by according different accounting treatment. So that we have to understand. The another situation may be section 43 CA. Section 43 CA, that if you are a real estate developer carrying on the business into the real estate, transferring land or building or both, which you are holding them as stock in trade for a consideration which is less than the stamp duty value, then stamp duty value shall be deemed to be the full value of considerations accruing as a result of the transfer. Now, whether this excess or the difference between the stamp duty value and the actual sale, now whether should also be added to the amount of turnover, that is also an aspect which has to be seen. Or if it is not to be added to the turnover, whether this amount itself is liable to be added separately as your income under section 43 CA, because section 44 AD says, notwithstanding anything contrary contained in section 28 to 43 C, there is no non-obstante qua section 43 CA. Therefore, this profit under section 44 AD at the rate of 8% covers section 28 to 43 C, but then anything which is not covered between these sections is not covered. Therefore, there can well be two possibilities, that this differential may be added by the assessing officer to the amount of turnover and then see whether it has crossed 2 crores. If it has crossed 2 crores, then you are out. If it has not crossed 2 crores, then pay 8% of this. There can be second alternative course, that he may take the turnover shown by you in your books, compute 8%, and then add this differential under section 43 CA separately, because on this ground that section 44 extending to section 28 to 43C is not with, it is not, not with extending to section 43CA, therefore it should be added separate. So these are the two exposures. These are the two points. Not settled jurisprudence is available, but then these are the areas to which, I mean, one must take care of. Now the same thing, that I declare income at 8%, but I earn say 15%. No, it's not permissible. As I said for 44 ADA, when I say that I declare my income at 8%, that means there is a presumption that the 92% has been spent. Now this 44 AD or ADA cannot be the source of creating capital by not paying taxes. There is no VDIS. That much we can understand. And at the same time, we must appreciate this thing that 44 AD or ADA, they are not withstanding to section 28 to 43C. But then any other section, I mean, its impact and import is not diluted. Now, you cannot be heard saying, or the person who is following 44 AD cannot be heard saying, ki saab, main to kitabe rakhi nahi raha hun, to meri khaton mein ya mere bank mein जो भी पैसा आया हुआ है, यू कैन नॉट आस्क. नो, डेफिनेटली इफ द अमाउंट इन द बैंक इज इक्वल टू द अमाउंट ऑफ द टर्नओवर व्हिच यू हैव डिक्लेयर्ड, देन इज ऑल राइट. बट देन इफ देयर आर डिस्प्रोपोर्शनेट डिपॉजिट्स इन द बैंक अकाउंट, और इफ देयर इज सम अदर एसेट. आई रिमेंबर इन वन ऑफ द केसेस देयर वॉज अ सर्वे इन केस ऑफ वन ऑफ माई एसएससीज. He said that I am following 44 AD, I am not required to maintain books of accounts, and very fact I am not maintaining books of accounts. But then the stocks which were there, that was valued, and that was found in crores of rupees. Now SSE said and kept on harping upon, sir, you cannot ask me because I am not maintaining. How can I prove? How can I substitute? No, I mean, this kind of an argument is not available. Now if there are some disproportionate amount of investment which can be justified with the help of your this year's income or the past year's income, then the burden is on you, because these sections are not withstanding to any other section. They are not withstanding to section 68 or 69 A, B or C. Therefore one cannot take a shelter or cover, or one cannot make an alibi. Sir, since I am not maintaining books of account and therefore I am immune to your all questions. No, and that is not permissible in law. There are other questions also, but now it's 7, almost 2 hours, but then there are questions also. So there are other issues also, but then we can take it some other time. And there are questions, some questions have been sent by Arunji also. Now let me find out as to what are those questions. Arunji, yes. So AO has invoked the provision section 50C, and accordingly they worked out long-term capital gain as per stamp valuation. Actual lesser amount was received as per sale deed. And net capital gain was also invested in NHAI bonds. AO did not agree and made assessment, and he has also issued penalty notice under section 270 capital A. Can he levy penalty being deeming provision of section 56? Dekho, let us first of all understand. I mean, I want to displace that common misconception about law, that if there is some addition under the deeming fiction, then the penalty cannot be levied at all. This is a wrong misconception. Let us be very clear. And the reason I am giving, and reason is like this. Now, if the legislature says that a particular thing will be deemed to be in this manner, this is as clear as the daylight on the statute, and yet one chooses not to follow, then why should this SSE be treated differently? Merely because that the legislature is creating fiction. Legislature has created fiction for everybody, and that fiction has been created to be followed. Therefore, let us be clear that there can be no fiction, first of all, that deeming provisions cannot lead to the levy of penalty. First of all, let us remove that kind of misconception. Now, under section 270 capital A, as Somil has explained very nicely, what has to be seen is whether there is any addition of whatsoever nature in the assessment order. If yes, then that is underreported income. Now, if you want to exclude something out of it, then make out your case under subsection 6. Now, here you can make out a case under subsection 6, small a. Sir, you furnished explanation as to why you did not opt for stamp duty valuation for the purpose of computing capital gain. Because according to you, which should be based on some plausible evidence, the actual market value was this at which this transaction was carried out and not the stamp duty value. And here is the evidence. And therefore, when I have made explanation, that explanation is supported by evidence, and therefore bona fide cannot be questioned, and therefore it should be taken out. If assessing officer does not take it out, then the commissioner appeal would take it out. The commissioner appeal does not agree with you, then the tribunal is there. But you cannot be heard saying, since it is a deemed income, it is an income based on a fiction. But then fiction is applicable to me, to you, to everybody. So this is my answer to that. Can a practicing CA, let me have water, please. Can a practicing chartered accountant who is a partner in a CA firm and also doing the practice in his individual capacity claim the deduction under section 44 ADA? I've already given answer. As a partner, he is drawing fixed remuneration from his CA firm and earns professional fee from his individual practice as well, although the proportion of earning through individual practice is approximately 10% of the gross receipts. I have given already answer that according to me, even his capacity as a working partner should be taken 2B1 as covered under section 44 ADA, but of course subject to the decision of Madras High Court in A. Anand Kumar's case. He incurs expenses such like on books and periodicals, petrol, car, driver, salary, telephone, business, depreciation, laptop, mobile. These are not claimed in the partnership firm as expenses. So these may not be claimed. But then if you are covered under 44 ADA, then it is all right. Then even if you have incurred these expenses, nothing will be allowed to you. But then if you are not under 44 ADA, then of course they are liable, whether they are liable against your salary income, partner salary income, or your individual practice income, these are reliable. What are the preconditions, challenges to avail 44 ADA, and if not, then why not? I have already answered. One more query is penalty 270 is compulsory. Yes, that I have already answered. Now, there are 12 question answers. Let me read them. Rakesh Sharma, sir. Can addition 14BA treated as underreported where a calculation? एक मैं इस बात पर भी क्लियर करना चाहता हूं, तो Somil has answered it, but I want to supplement it. Addition under section 14A be treated as underreported where calculation were provided by the SSE. Nahin, calculation can be provided by the SSE, may not be provided by the SSE. The calculation has to be calculated as per Rule 8D. So merely because SSE has calculated it, then also nothing turns against the SSE. Even if the assessing officer has done it, then also nothing goes in favor of the SSE. Now, even if that 14A disallowance has been made as a particular percentage of total administrative expenses, and thereby what is implicit in this question seems to be that since it is based on some ad hoc percentage, but then ad hoc, it's not ad hoc. That percentage is given under Rule 8D. And if there was taxable income, tax-free income, and there are expenses under section 14A read with Rule 8D, which will be said to be incurred in relation to that exempt income, and yet I do not make disallowance, then there is a problem. Though you may try to make out your case under subsection 6 clause A, and your doors will not be slammed against your face merely because you yourself have provided the calculation. Because Somil has said, if you remember one very important proposition of law, that assessment and penalties are two separate, distinct and independent provisions. Now, something may be disallowable in assessment, but then in penalty proceedings, you can make out a case that despite the additions having been made against me, but then the penalty cannot be imposed. So you make out a case. And penalty be levied. अच्छा इसी का है सो पेनल्टी इवन इफ लेविड बट देन यू कैन कंटेस्ट इट यू मस्ट कंटेस्ट इट मेयरली बिकॉज यू योरसेल्फ प्रोवाइडेड शुड नॉट बाइंड यू अतुल पुरी सर इफ ए प्रोफेशनल सी इज फाइलिंग द रिटर्न अ प्रेजम्प्टिव स्कीम कैन द डिपार्टमेंट आस्क फॉर द प्रोडक्शन बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट टू वेरीफाई द प्रॉफिट वाज एक्चुअली मोर नो नाउ फॉर दिस पर्पस दे कैन नॉट आस्क फॉर इट बिकॉज इफ आई एम फाइलिंग द रिटर्न आई मीन बट देन Of course, if your books of accounts, if you which you were otherwise obliged to maintain as per the institute's guidelines or regulations, but then if they are showing more profits, then of course, I mean, then the problem is bound to be there. Nidhi Agarwal, a partnership professional firm having turnover 2 lakhs and showing profit about 10,000. Yes, it is liable to tax on it because professional firm having total income more than the basic threshold limit, that is zero, now here is profit 10,000, then of course the tax audit, I mean, would be required to be done. For section 44 AD, how many years we have to see backward for application? From assessment year 17, 18 onwards, you have to see. Atul sir, kya keh rahe hai? Person engaged in the business of operating goods carrier had 9 vehicles and he used under exchange scheme. And he under exchange he got 2 vehicles, but the dealer did not transfer the old vehicles. What will be the status of the SSE? Will he be? No, he will not be, because now you see these are the movable assets and the movable assets are transferred by delivery. May not be the conveyance deed, but then here you have to show that you have handed over these vehicles or in fact you have sold them. That is a different matter that these have not been got registered in the name of the buyer. So if you are able to prove it, then it's all right. Ranjan Sehgal, sir, as you said, a part of professional can avail benefit 44 ADA, even then he has justified 50% expense and cannot capitalize both the salary and interest of firm. Secondly, before 89, partner share from firm was taxable. From 1989, taxation of firm was changed and profit share was made exempt in hands of partners. That was made from 1993, not from 89. Was made exempt in the hands of partners and interest and salary from firm was made taxable in the hands of partner. The CBD has clarified by circular that salary and interest to partners is nothing but distribution of profit of firm. And as a due date of partner will be same as in the case of firm. So question kya hua? Main samajh nahi paya main. Question to hua hi nahi. Amit Mishra sir kya keh rahe hain? Sushil Agrawal sir, if remission interest of a partner from CFR is more than 50 lakhs, then whether the party is liable to tax audit for such income? According to me, yes. Have a doubt that whether Google AdSense ये क्या होता है मुझे नहीं मालूम Google AdSense क्या होता है चौमिल do you know Google AdSense क्या होता है
probably जो Google पे जो advertisements करते हैं हाँ दिए जाते हैं उसके लिए बात कर रहे हैं
it is not profession ad if there are only advertisements I mean it's not professional it may well be a service And like same, it would be covered under which section 44AD or 44AD in situation gross Manoj ka hi hai. And like same, it would be covered under 44AD or 44ADA in situation having gross is 40 lakhs. So it can be under 44AD, but then 44AD is not applicable. If your turnover is not more than 2 crores, if your turnover is less than 2 crores of rupees, you want to declare. And if you're carrying on eligible business, then of course you can declare 8%, but then whether it is a business carrying on eligible business, because if you read subsection 6 or explanation 2 to section 44AD, which defines business in the most comprehensive manner. Now it says 44AD subsection explanation, eligible business means any business, except the business of hiring, plying or leasing goods carriages and whose turnover. So, I mean, if you're carrying on this kind of a business, then it's all right. Small LIC agents, how can escape to keep books of account that is less than 50,000 yearly commission? Now, if you are earning commission, then you are not under section 44AD. then you have to maintain books of account provided the conditions section 44AA subsection 2. But then there you have to keep the books of accounts, because under section 44AA subsection 2, I mean, there are monetary limits which are there. So question to sare ho gaye, isme bhi hai kya, chat mein bhi hai kya questions? पीपीटी तो भाई हमारा होता नहीं करुणा जी, आपने देखा, आपने कौन सा पीपीटी देख लिया जो आप पूछ रही हैं कि पीपीटी ऑफ द सेशन? आई मीन वी स्पीक एक्सटेम्पोर, एट बेस्ट आई मीन सोमिल टेक्स हेल्प ऑफ दिस स्क्रीन फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ सेक्शन. आई डू नॉट नो, आई मीन अवर ऑडियंस दे कीप ऑन आस्किंग पीपीटी, बट वेदर if at all there was any PPT, if at any stage you found that, I mean, we are referring some PPT. I mean, putting question just for the sake of question, I mean.
Sir, एक कमल गुप्ता भी पूछ रहे हैं.
कहाँ हैं कमल गुप्ता जी, हैं कहाँ?
सर ये सर क्वेश्चन Q&A में नहीं, ना चैट में डाल दिया है क्वेश्चन.
ये कितने बजे का क्वेश्चन है?
ये 6:23
का. 6:23 का क्वेश्चन है.
मैं पढ़ देता हूँ सर.
Income 50%, but books showing income more than, ये मैंने already deal कर दिया है. If you are earning more than 50%, then you will have to declare that much.
7:09 पे है जी.
7:09 पे किसका है?
नहीं गया है जी, केवल गुप्ता जी का.
GST included in 44ADA professional receipts. Yes, yes. According to me, yes. So now all questions are over, time is over.
Yeah.
So up, in fact, Arunji, I try to ensure that we finish within the time prescribed, because almost there are everyday webinars. So if the time gets expanded every day, then that becomes difficult. So it's almost 2 hours, and 2 hours was the time. So I thank you on my behalf and on behalf of Somil for such wonderful audience, wonderful panel. Thank you to each one of you from the core of our hearts, my galaxy of listeners, professional friends. Thank you from the core of our hearts.
Thank you. I request to Rajesh Arora ji kindly give a vote of thanks to.
Sir, I on behalf of North Tech Study Circle, with our senior brother Azim Kumar Gupta ji, Raman Gupta ji, and Ashok Gupta ji, thank you very much to the both of speaker, Dr. Rakesh Gupta ji and C.A. Somil Agarwal ji. And I also thank to all attendees. All attendees, sir. Both eminent speakers discussed their topic regarding penalty and presumptive taxation. At one time, there are more than 275 members. And I also thank to Shri Ashok Sharma ji, our senior member, for sparing their precious time. I offer them bouquet and a shield to both of the speakers. Thank you very much to the both of the speakers and Sri Ashok Sharma ji. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Message
देना चाहते हैं तो? नहीं, अगले सेमिनार का नहीं है.
Keep yourself safe. Stay home as much as possible. Wash your hand often with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. Wear a mask. Wear a double mask. You are going out and put it on properly. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Aur Rajesh ji, second
dose. Haan ji. I second dose.